call the photograph.
Nydeo. There you go. It is a tall one. Six foot four, it looks like. I'm 6'2".
Good afternoon, everybody. If you could come on in and get seated, we'll get started in about 2 minutes. Nancy Jester, our county commissioner, is here, and Stan Jester, our school board rep, is here, Mayor Shortle, and we've got several members of the Dunwoody City Council, Doug Thompson, Pam Talmadge, Terry Nall, and John Hennigan, and I don't think I've missed anybody. But if I have, wave your hand wildly and I will recognize you. All right, no wild hand waving. The Dunwoody Homeowners Association was founded in 1970 with the goal of protecting Dunwoody as a place for families. And it's been instrumental in the development of Dunwoody over its almost 50 years. And I want to encourage you, if you are not a member, to become a member. It's $40 a year. We do great work, and one of the things we do is putting on forums like this pretty much for every election cycle. And today's event costs somewhere between $1,000 and $1,500 to produce, and the dues is what pays for it. So if you are think you might want to join, there are membership forums on the table outside, or you can go to our website, Dunwoody Homeowners Association.org. Before we get started, I want to remind the candidates and their surrogates about the appropriate placement for yard signs in Dunwoody. So, three rules, guys. Number one, you can't put your signs in the right-of-way. That's the first 10 feet from the curb. Number two, you have to have the property owner's permission. You can't be putting your sign in any vacant lot or any commercial property where you think nobody will pick it up. And we have a number of places in the city where there are, you know, every single one of you guys is represented, and we know that you don't have the property owner's permission to do that. And the third is, there is a prohibition against temporary signs in Dunwoody Village. So that's the two blocks on Mount Vernon, two blocks on Chandler Dunwoody, where there's a special sign ordinance which says no temporary signs. So that is verboten, but other than that, you're good to go.
Number four, you gotta pick them up afterward.
Yeah, we do ask you to pick them up afterwards. I do have a couple of thank yous that I wanna do. One, I do wanna thank all the candidates who are here today. Thank you very much. It is hard putting yourself out there, and we appreciate your efforts at serving our community, and we appreciate you making the effort to be here today, so thank you for that. I want to thank our Dunwoody police who are here today and keeping us safe, and we appreciate everything. And finally, I want to thank Dunwoody High School and Principal Tom McFerrin for letting us use this lovely facility. It is truly a benefit to the community to have something like this and to be able to use it. And the last thing I do before I want to go over the format is to remind everybody that starting tomorrow, we have early voting at the Dunwoody Library. Their early voting has already been going on in Fulton and Cobb, and in fact, we've had early voting in DeKalb, but it's been down on Memorial Drive. Starting tomorrow, you'll be able to vote at the Dunwoody Library, so don't wait till Tuesday the 18th. Go ahead and vote early. Yeah, 5 days, Monday through Friday at the library. The format. The seating up here today was random, so don't try to read anything into that. Each one of them picked a popsicle stick with a number on it, and that determined their seating. Where each candidate will get 2 minutes to make an opening statement. And we mean 2 minutes. Let me remind you what something my eighth grade English teacher kept telling me, which is brevity is the soul of wit. We will all appreciate it if you are brief. We have timekeepers down front. They will hold up signs giving you warnings. And then there's a little bell. Let's hear the bell. That's your, you've gone over. Once every candidate has done their introduction, we will ask a question, and each candidate will have 90 seconds in which to answer. We will start, the first question will go first to Bob Gray, all the way on that far end, and then they'll pass the mic down, each answering that question, and then the second question will be asked, and they'll get it starting with Rebecca on this end, and they'll go down the other way. We will ask as many questions as we have time for. We are slated to be done in 2 hours. So that's not a lot of time. So we'll see how many questions we can get through. And one last thing, this is a forum and not a debate. You don't get to interrupt a candidate. You don't get to have a rebuttal. And we ask the audience to be an audience and not to be a participant in the proceedings. Polite applause is, of course, appropriate, but they're the stars of the day, and we want to let them shine. So with that, we will start. And actually, I said Dan's going to get the first question. Dan actually gets the first introduction. And by the time the mic comes all the way down, Rebecca will get the first question. Everybody clear? All right. Bob Gray, you're up.
Hi, thanks so much for coming. There's something else going on today, so I appreciate making the choice to be here. I think the primary question you need to ask candidates is why are they running? And I'm running to save the American dream. My grandparents imprinted on me three fundamental American values, and those are self-reliance, independence, and personal responsibility. And when I look out and see the country and watch TV and see the protests, the violence, the effects of illegal immigration, I see that we've drifted so far from those values, it's time to recenter the country. And I intend to be a willing partner to our president, President Trump. I think we saw him in his speech to the joint session of Congress grow into the role of president, and he outlined 22 promises. There's not a single promise I disagree with. American people want something different. They want to see a change in D.C., and I want to use my 30 years of business experience to change the way we do business in D.C. I don't think you want to send politicians who want to be there for 10 or 20 or 30 years. It's time to send people who want to go to D.C. to do what's right, in spite of what the consequences might be for their own political career. Thank you for coming.
Hi, good afternoon, and thank you again for being here. My name is Keith Grauert. My website is keithforgeorgia.com. And I'm running because we need leaders of courage who are going to stand up to partisan interest and special interest. I grew up in Dunwoody around the corner, actually. My brother went to Dunwoody High School. I graduated from Marist, and then I went to Duke on an Air Force ROTC scholarship. After college, I went to pilot training in the Air Force down in Valdosta, and I lived all over the country and I lived all over the world. I served for a while in South Korea. I served in Eastern Europe for about a year and a half, where I worked extensively with NATO. And I've deployed to the Middle East four times, and in that time flew 497 combat sorties in Iraq and Afghanistan. I finished up my career at Andrews Air Force Base, and I'm still in the Air National Guard. And I did all of those things because I believe in the nobility of putting the country first and serving an interest greater than yourself. And that's what I think we're missing in Washington these days. And that's why I want to go to Washington and continue to fight for our country and to fight for you every day. I'm not a wealthy businessman. I'm not a career politician. I'm an ordinary guy who loves America and wants to keep fighting for America. So thank you very much.
Two minutes. That's how long we have to convince you how much we care about the American dream, how to tell you how qualified we are, to tell you how we will fight for what's right, to explain to you what our goals are and what we want to do if we're elected to this position in Congress. I am one of the five, my name is Richard Keeley, I'm one of the five Democratic candidates on the ticket here for this office. I was not born into privilege. I do not have a huge campaign war chest. It's just me, people who love, respect, and have backed me, fighting for the American dream. I was born into a working class family. I made it on my own. I went to college on an ROTC scholarship. I served my country as an officer in the United States Navy from 1987 to 1994. Where I learned the importance of America's diversity, the importance of America's leadership role in the world. After that, I became an educator and have taught at Georgia State University, teaching Italian and French, helping students achieve their dream of studying abroad. I will, if elected to Congress, fight for the values that I learned growing up. I was born in a working class family. My father worked in a factory until last year. I know what it means to struggle. That's why I will fight for working class people. I will fight for students. I will fight for the seniors who have already paid their fair share. I served in the military. That's why I will serve our veterans and keep our nation safe. I have taught in a public university. That's why I will fight for public education. If you vote for me, I will be a strong leader for the 6th District. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Muhammad Ali, the lightweight. But if you do vote for me and if I'm elected, I'll fight like heavyweight in Washington, D.C. I came to this country in 1986. Ronald Reagan was president. It took me 14 years to become citizen of this great country. And I did it the right way. I will touch on this during the Q&A, but I have limited time now. I was termed by a number of sources the best qualified candidate in this race, with PhD in economics, two MBAs, 30 years of professional experience, traveling more than 50 countries around the world, understand complex economic, political, social, cultural issues, which are critical for a congressman to deal with $20 trillion debt, complex foreign policy issues, war, whatever we are talking about. I strongly believe that we must keep our promise to our citizens, the senior citizens. They have done their share, so we should save Social Security and Medicare, and it can be easily done. There is a plan I have. Climate change is real. We must do everything possible. To save people and planet both. I'm also big on youth and women empowerment because I strongly believe empowered women can raise a better child, and empowered child can become a better citizen and better leader to take our country forward. Thank you. I believe world peace is possible if we do our part and give back to our community, and that is precisely why I'm running. Thank you so much.
My name is David Abrams, and just to tell you real briefly about me, I'm a CPA, then became an entrepreneur. I started a business converting vehicles to run on clean domestic natural gas. Yes, Republicans do care about the environment as well. It was a successful business. I was able to invest in my campaign. And I decided to do this because I see a broken political system. I see America in big trouble. We are seeing in this election outside influencers coming in and deciding for the people who they should vote for and who should represent the 6th District in Congress. And it's very disturbing to me. On the Democrat side, you have Nancy Pelosi and you have the Democrat Party choosing who voters should support on the Democratic side, and then what do we do in response? We put out, or not we, the Republicans in Washington, they put out ads accusing someone else running in this race for being tied to Osama bin Laden. It's disgraceful, it's disgusting, it's everything that's wrong with politics, and we need to get these special interests out of our politics. They are using the 6th District as a political football so that they can maintain their power in Washington, D.C. I'm fed up with it. I'm sick of it. I'm going to stand up to whatever and whoever is wrong in Washington, even if it's my own party. And I'm going to stand up for the people of the 6th District. I'm going to stand up for voters. Thank you very much. I hope I can count on your support.
David. Folks, I consider this a job interview. I'm Dan Moody, and I want to earn your vote today. And I want to tell you that I'm ready for the hard work, because that's what it's going to take to get this country back on the right track. I'd like my family to stand up, just real quickly, all of you. My wife, Stephanie, 47 years. She's been my best friend that length of time. My daughter, Tiffany. We've got Emily, Matthew, Allie, and Jack, her kids, and husband Jack in the back. Thanks for coming. Folks, Back in 2002, I was first elected to the state senate. And I'm sure some of you remember those days, because that's back when Fran Millar and Dan Weber and I started the path to create the city of Dunwoody. We did all the cities in North Fulton. Dunwoody was another one. And what a difference it's made. Back in 2002, when I first got elected to the state senate, Georgia had just started to turn red. And a lot of heavy lifting had to be done. And it was like a dog catching a car. A lot of folks didn't really understand what governing was like, and new leaders started to emerge. And I was one of them. I had served in the Army as an officer. I'd been in business since the early 70s. I'd owned my own business and created some great jobs in Georgia. Created a business worth millions of dollars to the economy. And in the state senate, I did my share of the hard work. But at the end of the day, I had always believed in term limits. So I term limited myself. I went back home to live under the laws I helped create. Today in Washington, we've got those same challenges. It's time to get to work. I'd love to earn your vote.
Hello, I'm Ron Slodin. I want to tell you about my background and why I'm running for Congress. I was born and raised in Atlanta, went to North Fulton High School, went to the University of Georgia, came out and worked at Portman Properties. I then ran for the state senate and was elected in my first run for public office. When I was in the state senate, we actually got things done. I was on the education committee when we passed the HOPE scholarship. That's the best program that's ever been passed in this state. We also cut taxes, gave teachers the pay raise they deserve, balanced the budget, and grew the economy. But just as important, when I was in the state senate, I have a record of working across the aisle with Republicans and legislators from all around the state to get legislation passed to get real results for the people of Georgia. And when I travel to the district, that's the biggest problem we have now. The fighting, the bickering, the gridlock in Washington, nothing's getting done. We have real issues in our community that need to be addressed. And I know this because I live, work, owned a business, raised my family, and volunteer in the 6th District for over 15 years. My kids attend public school at Lassiter High School. I'm a member of the PTA. My mom lives in Dunwoody. I've been active, a volunteer coach at the Marcus Jewish Community Center for years. So I'm very active, invested in this community. After politics, I opened an advertising agency in Sandy Springs. I helped start the Sandy Springs Chamber of Commerce. When I was with my ad agency, I was part of the four-person business development team that created the 2009 entertainment tax credits. Have you seen all the movie and TV productions going on in the state? That's because of these tax credits. There was even a film, they filmed several movies in Dunwoody. You might have seen Billy Crystal and Bette Midler walking around the neighborhood. But 2016 alone, there was over 240 movie and TV productions that created over $7 billion worth of economic development. So I'm running on the local issues. I'm running to create jobs, support our schools, and fix it, transportation problems. On the national level, I'm going to protect Social Security and Medicare. We're going to protect clean air and water. We're going to defend a woman's right to control her own health care decisions. We're going to make it. Go ahead. I'm Ron Slodin. I'm passionate about this community. I'm passionate about getting results. I ask for your vote. Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Karen Handel. Thank you all so much for being here. You could have been a lot of other places. It's beautiful outside, and we do have that little thing going on called the Masters. So I appreciate that you made time to come out today. We have a lot of talk going on in Washington. Republicans have talked for 8 years about everything that they're going to do. It's now time to deliver. And in the elected roles that I've had the privilege to serve, I've delivered for the Fulton County and for the state time and time again. My background, my career is anchored in the private sector, having held executive positions with KPMG and CIBA Vision. I served as CEO of the North Fulton Chamber of Commerce, taking that organization quite literally from the brink of bankruptcy back to solvency, while also creating tens of thousands of jobs, helping to create those jobs here in the North Metro area. When I was given the privilege of serving as Fulton County Commission Chairman, I inherited a $100 million budget deficit. No one thought that I would be able to balance that budget without tax increases, but I did, and I did it without a Republican majority. When I had the privilege of being Secretary of State, I was able to get photo ID implemented in a fair and appropriate way across our state so that we would have strong voter protections at the ballot box. We need to have our next congressman be someone who understands the community and the local issues, someone who will be a fighter for you. We need to repeal and replace Obamacare, jumpstart this economy so that we can lower taxes, create more jobs, get wages back to where they need to be, higher paying jobs. We also need someone who can work well with your local elected officials. Today marks the 19th anniversary of the devastating tornado that ripped through this community, creating so much loss. It's important to have someone who knows your mayor, who knows your council members, Terry Knowles. I'm grateful to have his support. We need to have someone who's going to be a fighter for you and not beholden to others. I'm running for Congress because I want to be that person to represent you and fight for you. I look forward to the questions and earning your vote. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Andre Pollard, and I'm running for Congress. I am a technologist, and I am part of what you would consider the resist movement. I'm one of the people that, you know, was watching TV, and I couldn't watch anymore, and I had to get up off the couch. When the Muslim ban got, the first time it got enacted, and it took Google, Facebook, Amazon, and 100+ companies to come out against the Muslim ban, and our congressional representative in Washington, quiet, not a peep. I knew that we, the technologists, do not have the proper representation in Congress. And that's why I have been very blessed in my life, decided to get up and do something about it. I am an immigrant. I came to this country when I was 10 years old. I married to a Latino, so half my household is Spanish speaking. I run the Alpharetta Ventures and Incubator Meetup Group. I run the Alpharetta Rails Coders with free website development classes on Saturday. You'll be surprised at all the people that show up at that, old, young, everyone. I started the Alpharetta Ionic 2 Mobile Development. Again, I'm pushing technology, and I have a lot of technology solutions. I've been doing this for over 4 years, so when you hear candidates talking about Silicon Valley of the South, I've already been doing that for 4 years. I'm a father of four, two teenagers, a four-year-old and a one-year-old, and basically, I am you. I am representing all of you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Bruce Lavelle. And thanks for coming out. And shouts out to Dick Williams here with the Dunwoody Crier. Let's give him a hand. Locally owned newspaper, which we should all go out and buy, support small business. My wife and I were a family owned business right here in Dunwoody on Ashford Dunwoody Road. It's called Dunwoody Diamonds USA. Some of y'all are wearing some of our engagement rings and nice little trinkets. Everybody raise your hand. The whole crowd raised their hand. I see a few. No, but thank you for patronizing us. But I attend North Point Church. My home is in Sandy Springs by the beautiful Chattahoochee River. And my business is, like I said, is right here in the city of Dunwoody. My beautiful wife is right here. Stand up, honey. Stand up. How beautiful you are. Isn't she awesome? And, my daughter, Leah, is her last year at University of Maryland. She attended Marist, and she currently works in the West Wing with Sean Spicer. My son attends Auburn University, go War Eagles, his freshman year football. Thank you, Amy, go War Eagles. Why I'm in this race, you know, like many of you, I suffered a catastrophic inconvenience, as you say, in my household with government overreach, bank loans being called for no reason. A lot of things that hurt a lot of us in this room, and thank God, hopefully we'll rebound for that. I want to be that champion to fight for you. How I can fight with you is the fact that no one owns me. I've totally disavowed all special interest groups, all PACs, no lobby money. Thank you. Y'all know how important that is. If you go to the FEC, you can see all these candidates, and you can find out where all the money's coming from. And you'll see who owns the candidate. They don't own Bruce Lavelle. Just remember that. That's a powerful asset to go to DC, guys, to fight for you. I was currently chairman at MARTA for 5 years, or 3 years I was chairman of operations. I think I can take a heavy lift. I was Donald Trump's top surrogate for years. I still do White House surrogate work. I think I can take that relationship and bring this worst traffic that we have in our corridor, that I know I can help mitigate some of this mess that we have. Bruce Lavelle, lavelleforcongress.com. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alexander Hernandez, and I'm proud to be the only truly independent candidate in a field of 18 candidates, meaning I've already put the district before any money, special, or partied interests, because the district is who I want to represent, not anyone else. I'm a working class candidate. My parents, my mom is a hairdresser, my dad was a steel worker, and they instilled in me these values, our Christian faith, and to work hard in pursuit of the American dream, and that's what I've done ever since. I got into this race because I knew that issues important to working folks were gonna be ignored had I not participated, and we're seeing that. Issues involving the income inequality in this country have been silenced, except for this campaign. We've been focusing on what matters, Social Security and Medicare, because that's our money and it needs to be there when we need it. I'm focusing on a plan that is an economic plan that gets its stimulus at our economy, and we start by investing in people. The way we do that is today we invest in infrastructure for jobs, and then we invest in education for future growth. We need to make sure that every school in this country is the best possible school, and that way we will keep up with the changing times, and we keep up, and that's what we need. That's a bare minimum. And then I have a plan that focuses on our veterans. Taking care of our veterans by giving them a raise, how do you pay for it? You go to the Pentagon and find over $6.5 trillion that's been lost over there over the last 10 years. No one's talked about the Pentagon. No one wants to audit the Pentagon. And that's absurd that we have people in Congress who are supposed to check the purse, and they don't do that. I want to go to Washington and check the purse again, making sure we hold the people who lose our money accountable and start diverting funds to our men and women in service as a thank you. And always looking through what can we do for the people first. What's going to benefit all of us as the baseline, and we build from there. My name is Alexander Hernandez, and my website is yourvotegeorgia.com, and I hope I can count on y'all's support. Thank you.
Thank you for being here today. I'm Amy Kramer, and I want to thank the Dunwoody Homeowners Association for putting this event together. I have to say that it's more than the 6th District GOP can do, because they have not been able to hold one event that has had all 11 GOP candidates there, and that's disgraceful, honestly. I am a lifelong resident of the district. I was born in Kennestone Hospital, graduated from Lassiter High School, and I went to this little school over in Alabama, War Eagle, for a time. Came back here to Atlanta, was a real estate agent and Delta Airlines flight attendant. I too, like Mr. Pollard, was sick and tired of yelling at my TV and radio and got off my couch and decided to do something about it, but it was about 8 or 9 years ago, and I'm one of the founders of the modern day Tea Party movement. Now, I'm not an extremist. I'm not the party of no or complete opposition all the time. What I want is I want Washington to work for we the people again. I think that Washington has gotten out of control. Most people go there with the best of intentions, but what happens? They become beholden to the special interests and the money that flows through Washington, and they no longer represent us. I don't think our founding fathers intended for people to go to Washington and to live there for 20, 30, 40 years, almost to their deathbed. There are people that have been there longer than I've been alive, and that's not acceptable. So I got involved in politics because I truly wanted to affect change. I think everybody says there's no silver bullet to fix healthcare. Well, I think there is a silver bullet. You make Washington live under the same rules as you and I and all Americans, it'll get fixed real quick. I too believe that we need tax reform. We need to repeal and replace Obamacare. I'm concerned about our national security. Those are all things that we're going to hear everybody up here talk about today. But at the end of the day, if the people aren't going to Washington and doing what they promised to do, then we're not going to get anywhere. I'm Amy Kramer, and I'd love to have your vote. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Judson Hill, and I'm thankful that y'all are here, and we're blessed to have this opportunity to visit with you today. America has a unique opportunity to change the course and get us back on the right track. And I think this election is all about trust. Which one of these individuals do you really trust? Who's pretending and who's not? Who's got the proven track record? The difference between everybody else, frankly, and me, is I've got a proven track record of working hard to create jobs, lowering your health care, and working hard to lower your health care costs across the state. and also stand up for conservative principles. It's that simple. We've worked hard to lower your tax burden across on each one of you, and it's that simple. A strong economy, a strong military, and protecting your conservative values, because I believe that the best predictor of what someone's going to do is what they've already done, right? So if you want to have, if you're going to have someone tell you what they're going to do, at least have them show you what they've already done. Make them show you what they've already done. With me, you've got a man of deep faith, a strong courage, and strong integrity. You've got a conservative reformer, a proven experienced track record of not just talking about this, but this very same year working hard for you in the Georgia Senate to do just that. Help make health care more affordable for you. I served in the Georgia Senate for 12 years. I worked for President Reagan. I've been a United States attorney. Different things along the way. But I'm a small businessman and done that for the last 15 years. I know where you live. I know what's important to you because I'm one of you. So if you want someone who's going to stand strong in their principles, elect me. Because I have a proven record of standing up for against the political establishment, the special interest. I got punished. I had a chairmanship taken away by this someone on this group here. I've had a chairmanship taken away. I've had been stuck in the corner. But you can't. You can tell me where to sit, but you'll never be able to tell me where to stand. And it's always with you. I promise to stand with you. I pledge to. And if you elect me, we're going to win again. I have for 7 times in a row. Thank you very much. I appreciate y'all being here.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you to the Homeowners Association. Thank you, Dick and Robert, for moderating. My name is John Ossoff. I was born and raised in Metro Atlanta, grew up in the 6th Congressional District in North DeKalb County, not too far from here. Went to Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service, where I studied international relations. I worked on Capitol Hill for 5 years, specializing in defense and national security policy. I saw how things work in Congress, but more than that, I saw how they do not. I saw the partisanship and the gridlock, the pettiness and the corruption. And I ultimately decided to leave. In 2012 and 2013, I got a master's degree from the London School of Economics. And I now run a small business that specializes in investigations of organized crime, political corruption, and war crimes around the world. We produce documentary films for international television broadcasters and news organizations. And I had no plans to get back into politics anytime soon. But the last 6 months have changed my worldview pretty profoundly. I think it's time for fresh leadership in Washington. Fresh leadership focused less on the endless partisan negativity that's drowning us in nonsense, and real results instead. The economic potential of our region here is virtually unlimited. We've got the busiest airport in the world, a deep water port in Savannah, a booming tech sector, especially in North Metro Atlanta. 600 tech companies around Alpharetta alone, nearly 200,000 people employed in high-tech economy in Metro Atlanta. And yet, instead of discussing what we can do to deliver the kind of solutions necessary to grow this economy into an economic powerhouse that's the envy of the rest of the country, we remain mired in gridlock, partisanship, negativity. I'm running a positive campaign that's focused on our shared prosperity, how we can grow this economy so families have more opportunity, higher incomes, more affordable college, and a better quality of life. And I think that that is a message that can cross party lines. I ask for your support on April 18th. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Kurt Wilson, and I have some bad news and some good news. The bad news is that Robert reported that this rank of order here was not according to polling data. So the bad news is that John is now 14th in the polling data and I'm 15th, just to let you know. Give me a straight scoop on the story here. The other good news is I can tell you that I have got to meet and know most of these 17 other candidates up here. And I will tell you, they're fine Americans. They're good people. They're honest people. They care. They want to do the right thing. And I can also tell you that most of the people that we elect to the United States House of Representatives and the United States Senate, a large majority of those people are good people. So what's wrong? What's the problem? And the reality is that we keep chasing shiny objects. Because what we really need at this point is the growth of government has gotten so large that you and I both know as regular citizens, it's breaking our backs. We also know something probably that we don't want to admit to ourselves, that we've gotten to a place that the founders were worried about, that where we've gotten to a place that where special interest and factions have taken over our government. And so it's no longer about D's and R's, it's about incumbency. It's about special interest. And so I tell you, as a normal citizen, an ordinary citizen who's never been in politics, why in the world would you do this? Because it's time ordinary people start standing up and changing our government again. And the first way we're going to do that was with a constitutional amendment to term limits, my friends. Whether you're Republican or Democrat, we have to do it. Because we can't focus on the four most important things to me that are in front of us that if we don't deal with, are going to destroy our country. We have to reverse the $20 trillion of national debt. We have to balance the budget every year. We have to repeal the 16th Amendment. And we have to derail and devolve the federal bureaucracy. My name is Kurt Wilson. I appreciate your support on April 18th. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Good, good. My name is Reagan Edwards. It's actually spelled R-A-G-I-N. Edwards is spelled correct. And I'm a professional and a mother. I actually graduated from high school right in the 6th District in East Cobb at Pope High. And then I went to Georgia Tech with the Hope Scholarship. Thanks for watching. I then moved up to Washington, D.C. and worked for a presidential appointee named Philip Moncada, who was actually appointed under George W. Bush. And that was my first mission, try to eradicate homelessness in America. After that, I had a stint at the Department of Energy under the civil rights lawyers. And then when I started a family, I decided to move to the best place in America, and that was back to the 6th District. You know, I've always been a political junkie ever since I was a kid, but I've protested and I have worked on different campaigns, you know, with my friends and trying to get younger people to vote. And I decided that it was time for me to take my turn and make my voice heard for the people. Because what we need in Congress are average people that have a heart for the people. And that's who I am. I come from a history of people that have fought for education and civil rights all the way from my great-great-grandfather to my grandpa, to my grandmother, to my mother, who was a woman that was in corporate America that made strides that helped other minorities have a voice. So I'm here today to tell you that the only way Americans can take back America is to make sure that there is truth and transparency in government and to use the tools that we already have to make sure this happens. My name is Reagan Edwards. Thank you for your time.
William Locke, my condolences to Phineas Hawk's family and friends and the entire Dunwoody community. We have a history in the 6th District of sending experts in their field to Congress. I am that expert in taxes and regulations. I'm a small business owner. I started a CPA firm right here in the 6th District over 30 years ago, born and raised right here, consulting business owners and individual taxpayers. I am completely aware of how middle-income Americans are paying the most tax, and I have a clear understanding of how the income tax code needs to be changed to make us successful. Also, what is important to me is education. As a father of two middle school students, this is a subject I care deeply about. Public education needs to be in the hands of the educators and local governments, and I am for school choice. On the college level, student loan debt is at $1.3 billion and counting. The government needs to step up and stop predatory lending. On the stance of a fair wage, I agree that an increase is needed to $9.70 an hour. Big corporations are taking advantage of the government assistance with their employees. This is corporate welfare, and we need to get these employers off the government payroll and give self-respect back to the people. I'm the middle brother of 11 siblings. With 62% Republican and 38% Democrats, my family, as well as our district, our dinner conversations get quite problematic. Yet in the end, an agreement is reached satisfactory to both sides. I need your vote to send me to Congress to represent you and facilitate the changes in the tax code that will support our business owners and middle-income taxpayers. We have enough congressmen supporting corporations, large corporations. Go to my website, LOP. Thank you. 2 and 10.
My name is Dr. Rebecca Quigg. First of all, I do want to extend my condolences about Phineas' death over the spring break. It's very sad to lose someone in the community at such a young age. I live in Cobb County, and my son is graduating from Pope High School, so I've been here many times. My son's a member of the Georgia Fencing League, and we've been to tournaments here and all over the district, and he's also a member of the competition marching band. So I've spoken to parents, families, relatives, friends, neighbors, all over about the issues in this district. And of course, one of the most important things is our public high schools. We need to make sure that we have the best K-12 education, and we need to make sure that our children can go to college debt-free. That's very important to me, and I will fight for those when I go to Congress. I'm a cardiologist, and my last position was as the director of heart failure transplant at Northwestern as associate professor of medicine. I'm a lifelong educator, and I mentored thousands of medical students, residents, and cardiology fellows, and trained them how to deal with patients so critically ill that they needed a heart transplant. During my time there, I published extensively peer-reviewed literature, and I lectured all over the world. Healthcare is a very important issue. And what I see is that we need someone in Congress that will work in a bipartisan way to make what we have better, expand it, and extend it to all Americans so that we all have coverage. We cannot take Medicare away from people that paid in for their entire life and give them a $200 voucher a month, and then next year it's $100, and maybe the year after $50. This is essential. Americans need to have health care. What I have found during my career is that you must work as a team, and I developed a multidisciplinary team that cared for thousands of critically ill patients. And when a family gave the gift of life, several surgeons tried to get the organs for their critically ill patients. And if I can navigate that, I certainly can navigate whatever party is discussing what issue in Congress. Thank you.
Before we get to the first question, I want to invite anybody who's standing over there who would like a seat. There are seats over here. We'll give you a second, and there's some seats on both sides. So we'll give you a second before we ask the next question. If you want to come sit, please do. If you're happy behind the curtain, feel free to stay there. I do want to make a couple of introductions now that the candidates have introduced themselves. I did not, in my initial comments, introduce Dick Williams, the editor of the Dunwoody Crier. We want to thank him. For his co-sponsorship and also for he's the soul of Dunwoody, and he's one of the reasons that we have the community that we have today. And it's one of the things that most of our northern neighbors are jealous about, is they don't have a community newspaper that does for us what the Crier does for us. So thank you for that. And I also want to introduce the board members of the Dunwoody Homeowners Association who are here. So if you are a DHA board member, would you please stand and be recognized? Thanks very much. Now we're going to go to our first question, and Rebecca gets to weigh in first. I'm going to turn around and look at them. So ladies and gentlemen, for the purposes of this question, assume that we have secured our southern border, whether it is a wall or a fence or more Border Patrol agents or a combination of all of the above, the southern border is secure.
Now, what do you do with the 11 million people who are undocumented or out of status who are here today?
Thank you for that question. It's very important. We have 11 million people here that are undocumented, maybe more than that. The issue is we need a comprehensive, kind immigration reform policy. We cannot take 11 million people that we allowed over the last few decades to work in our homes, work in our yards, care for our children, and then say we're going to rip them from their families. I believe that we should have a way for a path to citizenship. These people should pay for their fair share of taxes. That's been the concern, is that they're using resources, so let's do that. Now, of course, the criminals, the hardened felons with repeat offenses, they need to be deported. And that book's been on the law, and that needs to be taken care of. But I don't think we need a deportation task force that takes everyone, no matter what their walk of life, whether they've been a criminal or not, and rip them from their homes. Thank you.
William Lopp, on the stance of immigration, I live it. I'm a first-generation American. I do not support the shipping of 11 million immigrants out of this country. Go to my website and you'll see that I have a plan, or I have a recommendation for a plan that says, if you can prove you've been here for X number of years, you will be allowed legal status and never be allowed to vote. It's really that simple. File your income tax returns, pay the taxes that are due, pay a fee, and become part of our society that you already are a part of. What scares me the most is what I read in the paper just this past week. Fear in our community for these people that have been here for 10 and 20 years. We can't have that. We are not a Nazi state. We live here. They became part of our community, although illegally, but we have allowed them to stay for excess numbers of years. Give them a legal status, never be allowed to vote. Thank you so much. William Locke, LLP. Thank you.
First, let me say that I think the wall is not a good idea. I mean, 40% of the illegal immigrants come in by plane. So, I mean, it's just not a good idea. Immigration reform definitely needs to be had. We need to have a path to citizenship for the hardworking, immigrants that are here that have families. I've spoken to people, and I spoke to some high school students not too long ago, and their friends are literally worried and scared, and we're talking about what's going to happen. We don't know if my parents are going to be here. We're worried. We're scared. We have people that are leaving their jobs and not showing up again because they're worried about ICE coming and taking them. They should not be worried. They should not be able to not sleep at night because they're worried about somebody coming to pick them up. So first, we need to change the dialogue. We need to make sure that they feel safe in their own home, safe in America. And we need to have that path for them to become legalized citizens and pay taxes like the rest of us do. And I believe that if we continue down this path, it's gonna hurt other industries. It's gonna hurt the housing industry. There are apartment buildings that keep people that get up and leave, and they lose all of that income, and apartment homes will have to close like they did back when Barack Obama had a huge take of immigrants. So, immigration reform. Thank you so much.
So Robert, in direct response to your question, I have four responses. The first one is, like most of you, I know some illegal immigrants. And the illegal immigrants I know are fantastic people. But there's a problem. They're illegal immigrants. And I take you back to the 1986 Simpson-Mazzoli bill, which dealt directly with the issue of amnesty. It failed. So I have a plan that I want to deal with the so-called 11 million people. My proposal is that I call it the 7-year repatriation rule. So if it's a nuclear family with children now in school, primary school age, and the family can demonstrate they've been here 7 years, I am receptive to a path to citizenship, but the family must receive no government assistance, there must pay a fine, and there must be a clear path where they not only learn the language, but become full citizens of the United States of America. Thank you.
The notion that we are going to massively deport more than 11 million people is absurd. There is no way a program like that could be implemented constitutionally in a way that is fiscally responsible or in a way that is humane. The only real solution is comprehensive immigration reform that secures our borders and provides a path to legal status for non-felons who are here without proper documentation.
Thank you very much for the question as well. I don't believe in amnesty. I know we are a compassionate nation, but we're also a nation of laws. And we also want to make sure that those people here that are here, they're here for the United States' best interest. So if you support our values, if you support the United States Constitution, if you support our principles and you want to contribute, then I'm fine with more and more people coming in, but don't put someone who's here unlawfully ahead of the line and give them special treatment for those immigrants who have waited and followed the rules. As well as, we shouldn't treat someone here unlawfully better than American citizens. You shouldn't get special treatment. I believe we should implement the fare tax, among other things. You would open up the opportunity for all those people that are here unlawfully to contribute into the tax system, because we are protecting and working for and trying to develop affordable health care, world-class education, and all sorts of things to educate our young people and also provide jobs and a better opportunity for job creation, that environment that we've had here in Georgia and done over the last 4 years to make us number one. But we need to stand up for Americans and America first. I believe we should have a bill, pass a law that says that the official language of government is English. And I also believe that we should continue to enforce our immigration laws and make sure that those work first and revise and reform our visa entry system to make sure that America wins first. If you want to come here and follow our laws and be an American, then you can, but you have to follow our laws first. Thank you.
I too believe that we're a nation of laws, and I do believe that we should build a wall, and I believe that there need to be other approaches to secure our national, our southern border. And the reason is not just because of illegal immigrants, but because of the drugs that are coming across that border, as well as the threat of ISIS infiltrating refugees and coming across that border. We saw it happen in Brussels and Paris, and it's a very real threat that I think needs to be dealt with. Now, I believe that we are not going to ship, round up 11 million people and send them home. But I do believe, like I said, we are a nation of laws, and we do not need to incentivize people to come here and break our law. I personally believe that we need to end birthright citizenship. That's one thing I do believe. And I also think that we need to get rid of the bad guys and get them out of here. As President Trump said, get rid of the bad dudes. And then we look at a case-by-case basis. If people have been living here, their families are here, then we figure out a way for them to become legal and give them a legal status. But I do not believe in granting them citizenship or voting rights. And I do have a problem when we are treating illegal aliens better than we are treating our veterans. And that's a serious problem that I think we need to deal with across this country.
Thank you for that question. I think the key part you mentioned was the border is secure. So folks, 1986 amnesty that Ronald Reagan did is what we should follow as the model. Because that, when people say that that failed, was because they point to the security of the borders. But in this hypothetical, they're secured. So we follow Ronald Reagan's model. And I personally know this story because my mother came here illegally in the 80s. And thanks to Ronald Reagan and that amnesty, they found a pathway to citizenship. We became part of the American dream. We became part of this country that makes it so great. My mom now runs her own beauty shop. After being here illegally, she kept lifting up her bootstraps, you know, that whole story. What some folks say, this is what we should do. Lift yourself up by your bootstraps. Do the work. My mother did that and became part of what makes this country great. So in this hypothetical situation, the borders are secure. We must follow that model of creating a pathway to citizenship because that's what makes this country great. We are the melting pot. We are the United States of America. We're not this country that is so afraid of something different. That is scary. That is fear and fear itself. That is what we were told would happen. And here we are today. Just because someone looks a little different, someone is coming from somewhere abroad, we fear it. Why? These people just want to come here and be a part of the American dream. They want to participate and pay their dues, and that's what's so important to remember. We all came from somewhere else. Everyone in this room, eventually someone came from somewhere else. The pilgrims didn't have the right documentation to come into this country, but they did it anyways, and that's what makes this country great. Thank you.
I thought I was going to have to jump on and go hit me. Man, I'm bigger than you, dog. No, you know, the immigration, hot topics, guys. It's been going on since the election, very hot topic. I will tell you this, Republicans and Democrats have failed miserably in that policy. And I got to, you know, a lot of this conversation we're about to say here, no one has really talked about the employer of knowingly and willingly hiring undocumented workers that incentivize people to come across the border and paying wages under the table. That's what's killing us, guys. You know, yes, you know, we have 11 million. No, I don't believe we just throw families away. But I do like the idea of self-deportation. Self-deportations, go to the INS office, go back and go through the process. Guys, the laws are already on the books. Just abide by them. They're very simple. That's what God is doing to us. You know, I had an employee that worked for me, and Dr. Boehm now, he's a neurosurgeon. And my wife and I worked with him through that pathway to citizenship. That's where it's at, guys. The system is already there. You know, don't point the finger. You point the fingers at Democrats and Republicans. We turned an eye. We have strained our health and human resources, our hospital systems, everything. So I believe in the strong border too, guys. And a lot of the families in here are having some friends and family, their kids are going through heroin addictions. Those drugs are coming across that border. Thank God for Chris Christie being on that commission. Because we're going to put a stop to that. And they're coming through by ground. They're not coming through by air. Thank you.
I think I'm a little different from most people. Maybe because I'm an immigrant. And I consider my life here very successful. But when you look at countries like Russia, China, Germany, right? Someone joked the other day that the leader of the free world was meeting with Donald Trump. I didn't think that was too funny. I don't know about you. But what these countries all figured out is that resources, people, land is power, right? So you know where I'm going with this, right? If the European Union can integrate 28 different countries, why can't we move our border to the south of Mexico? Let's work with the Mexican government, secure the Mexican southern border, and let's work on integrating America and Mexico, who those people are already mostly American. Thank you.
Yeah, I definitely don't support that. This is a very serious issue. You know, back under President Reagan, there was mass amnesty, and then the borders were not secured. And folks, here we are again, deja vu all over again. No amnesty, no automatic path to citizenship. These individuals have come to our country and blatantly disregarded our laws. What do you think would happen to any of you in this room if you went to another country and blatantly disobeyed their laws? We cannot, we should not reward that. No amnesty, no ability to vote, get those borders secure, and then let's have a conversation. But I'm not prepared to deal with the hypothetical of the borders being secured. I want our borders secured first, and then we'll have that conversation. Thank you.
We're not going to deport 11 million immigrants. So we have to develop a pathway to citizenship. Most of these families are contributing members to society, and a lot of their kids are in our public schools and are American citizens. Can you imagine that moms and dads are leaving notes for their kids because they're living in the shadows, they're living in fear? If they get stopped for just a traffic incident, they could be deported. So they're leaving notes for their kids. Get in touch with these family members. Here are our bank accounts. Here's what you need to know in case of emergency. People shouldn't be living this way. We've got to create a bipartisan approach to creating a pathway to citizenship and make sure these people are not living in the shadows and not living in fear. They can even report, if a woman is domestic abuse, I know she'd be scared to call the police because she'd be scared she would be deported. So we don't need people living in this situation. So my solution would be to create the pathway to citizenship. Thanks.
First of all, this country is based on being a nation of laws. How in the world did we get 11 million people in this country illegally? And we don't even know if it's 11 million. Nobody's gone around and counted all these people that are here illegally. And let's go back to the question that was framed for all of us. It was pointed out in the question, make the assumption that the border is finally secured. And I've got to tip my hat to President Trump. He ran on that policy, on that platform. He has pledged to secure the border, and I am 100% behind him. It's finally time to secure our border in this country. We are a country of laws. I am not in favor of mass amnesty. The felons, get them out of here first. The rest, then we can talk about it, because we don't know how many people we're talking about. Thank you.
You know what I find very interesting? Hearing all the candidates talk about this issue, there seems to be some consensus. I agree that the question is a big if. We know we need to secure the border first. We know that having a broad-based immigration reform doesn't work. The American people don't trust us to do that. We need to secure the border first. And then I think we have a broad consensus that once we do that, we can have a compassionate solution. I would love to bring people out of the shadows so that so they can be protected, so that they can go to the police if there's an issue. I don't like people living in the shadows. We have to secure the border first. And then we can talk about legal status, which I think we should have. And if they want to become citizens, they need to do it the right way. So there's some pretty broad-based consensus about that. Why haven't we been able to get it done? Why haven't we been able to get it done from right to left? We know what the process has got to be. We are so dysfunctional that we cannot get this done at all. It's become a major issue in this country. We know how this needs to work, and yet because our partisanship is so deep and we're not willing to do what's right for the American people, we're not willing to do what's right for the interest of the voters, we're not solving this problem. It's a shame. We need to start working together. We need to solve these problems. We know what the answers are, and it's time we start working together for solutions for the American people.
I came here 30 years ago legally. My wife and I have been married for 30 years. We're a perfect example of a legal process. I support that, but having said that, I came here in 86 when Ronald Reagan was president and he did the amnesty with the hope that you solve the problem. But we still have that problem. Why? Because both parties have pondered this to get more votes. They have allowed people to come in and whenever they wanted to take advantage of that. Democrats opposed that amnesty during Reagan's time, during Bush's time. Now because Trump opened his big mouth, Democrats are trying to sell that against and suddenly has become immigrant friendly. They have never been that immigrant friendly. So let's make sure we understand. It is both political parties. They have created this problem purposefully. If we can pinpoint a criminal halfway across the world and put a drone and kill that person right there, we definitely can control the border here. So we should be able to do that. The reason we don't do that, because both parties have vested interest. And why? Because these congressmen get sold out before they get elected. They take so much money from different interest groups, so they can't do anything. So every interest group has vested interest in keeping millions of immigrants so they make money off of it. So the bottom line, it should be resolved humanely. Thank you.
I've agreed with a few things that were said, that there were some mistakes that were made. First of all, the immigrants were counted. There's a census every 10 years, and they count people, they count bodies, they don't count citizens. And they're the reason we have one more congressman and the reason that the redistricting was done. And so that's why we're here today trying to select another congressman and why someone from Tucker is in the district in the first place. Second, the wall is a big contract for construction companies. That's what it is. I talked to a military expert in fortifications. He says the number one rule in fortifications, any fortification can be broken. So if we build this big nice wall and write in gold letters TRUMP, then we will have people coming in containers on ships. So it's just a way to give another contract to a company. Corporations were complicit in this. I agree with Bruce on that. This has been a long-term trend. You've read The Grapes of Wrath, you've seen the movie. The Okies were taken from Oklahoma and they were used in California because they needed lower paid workers. We need to strengthen our labor unions so that we can pay our unions a fair job. And we need to recognize that these people that have been here for 10 years have been paying their taxes. Go to Plaza Fiesta. You will see the businesses that they built here. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe that immigration, when conducted legally and in the context of American interest, is a national asset and a true win-win. Without a secure border and without enforcing the laws that are actually on the books, you have this debate. And that's the United States of America today. I agree that there's not a fiscally responsible or morally responsible way to deport 11 million people. I think we prioritize the violent criminals. We do secure the border because that is a big assumption in this, obviously. And as far as the rest, I do not support a path to citizenship. I don't think we should. I think it's unfair. I would be open to a path to legal status where people can come out of the shadows, pay a fine, and continue to work here. But if people want to become citizens of this country, they need to follow the process that already exists. Thank you.
I'm very grateful that President Trump brought this issue up because it's bringing it into focus, and I don't think it would have been otherwise. We have first always been, and we need to recognize that we always will be, the land of opportunity. Every ethnic group that's ever come here has come here for the same reason, and that is to invest in themselves, invest in society, and we should encourage that. However, we need to understand the reason why we have seen illegal immigration. It's for two reasons. And if you're a business person, you gotta start by clearly identifying the problem rather than talking in platitudes. So there's two reasons we're seeing this. First, the benefits. There's tremendous welfare benefits available to those that come across this border illegally. I'll give you some examples. When Obama started his administration, we were spending about $45 billion in welfare. Today, we're spending over $500 billion a year. That's a big problem. We gotta turn off the spigot that attracts illegal immigrants. Second, we don't have the proper e-verify system to ensure that employers we need to ensure that employers are hiring only those that are legal. So what's the solution? We have to control the border. Every country on the planet, and I've been to 34, control the border through some form of physical barrier, cybersecurity, and other means to ensure that people come in and they know who they come in. We also have to know when they've left. So we need the ability to prevent visa overstays, and we have to have a prioritized path to return that's pragmatic. Thank you.
Thank you, folks. The newsman in me cannot resist a couple of updates. The Braves lead. The leaders are teed off at the Masters. And the president hasn't tweeted today. So far as I know. By the way, thanks to the DHA board members who worked hard coming up with questions. This is a hard task with 18 of y'all, and time is limited, and so I think they've done a great job condensing questions about the key issues in the race, and this one's kind of a catch-all. There's a natural tension between wanting lower taxes, wanting deficit reduction, and wanting to invest in infrastructure and so forth. You can't really do all three, so I'd ask you, starting at that end with Bob Gray, which of these sort of competing demands is most important to you?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the three?
Sure. Well, it's just a natural tension between lowering taxes, reducing the deficit, and wanting to invest in things like infrastructure.
Sure. So those are not mutually exclusive. By reducing taxes and deregulating certain industries, we will be able to rapidly grow the economy. We've enjoyed 1% growth, annual GDP growth over the last few years. There's no reason why we can't return that to 4 to 5% GDP growth if we do tax reform and deregulation of certain industries. We have to control the deficit and the debt. The numbers don't mean anything to anyone anymore. They're so large, they're so abstract. You have to reduce it to a problem you can understand. I'll give you an example. So let's say your household was earning $25,000 a year. You're spending $38,000 a year and you have $142,000 of debt. That's the size of the problem that we have to solve. As individuals, we have to appreciate that and solve that problem. Third, regarding infrastructure, we have an infrastructure that is decaying, and we must invest in roads and bridges to return the quality of that transportation system so that it can enable a growing economy. We also have to invest in a cybersecurity system that can help us ensure national defense. I'll give you two examples. The missile's going to launch from North Korea, and it will at some point have a nuclear warhead. We've got to be able to prevent that missile from taking off rather than hoping we can shoot it down. And we also have a communications and electrical distribution infrastructure that is woefully undefended, and we've got to be able to defend that, and we'll do so with cybersecurity. Thank you.
Thanks, yeah. I would say the issue in that question is that you're assuming the government should continue to be funded at the same level or continue to be involved in some of the things that it continues to be involved in, because I don't think lowering taxes and reducing the deficit are mutually exclusive. One, because I think lowering taxes is one of the best things we can do for the economy right now. We'll start growing the economy, we'll start bringing more revenues in that way. Secondly, I think we have seen an unsustainable growth in government generally. So we need to start looking very hard at the programs that we have and maybe start rolling back the growth of the federal government. And as far as infrastructure, you know, infrastructure really is an investment in the future. Infrastructure is something that the government is uniquely positioned to finance and plan for and help institute. But when you do it purposefully and don't build bridges to nowhere, but actually invest in the infrastructure that's going to contribute to your communities and contribute to your economy, then that also has the possibility of growing revenues and helping the economy in the long run.
Yes, we need to balance the budget, but not on the backs of seniors, veterans, and working families. For a long time, we've heard that we could not fund education, we could not fund the arts, we could not fund any of the things that everyone likes to have to build community because of the budget deficits. And now we have a budget proposal that increases budget deficits by giving large tax cuts to billionaires and in large giveaways to the things that we like, such as national defense, without having even evaluated the military needs that are behind those. So there are studies out there that conservatively say that if we could limit the increases in the size of government for a number of years, keeping everything the same, that we would balance the budget. We did this once, 1998 to 2001. I think we should look to that for an example.
I'm the only economist among all the 18 candidates. So I do understand the basic principles that needs to be followed. The reducing taxes, my position is different from the rest of the pack. I think the reduction of taxes should be done from the lower and middle income group so that they actually spend the money that creates demand, which creates more need for production, more need for workers, so things go on right direction. If you cut taxes at the top, it does not help. We have seen that again and again, that does not work. So that's one part of it. The second, the best way to reduce deficit is to create high-paying new jobs. We have to train our people to be globally competitive so that they can take those jobs as opposed to bringing foreign workers to do the job. So that's important. Once you have more people in the high-paying job, that pays more taxes to the government, so the government has more money, so they don't need to raise taxes, they can cut the deficit, and eventually the $20 trillion debt can be resolved, which is threatening our whole existence. So you need a qualified person, Muhammad Ali for Congress.com, and I'm the second on the top of the ballot, you can't miss it, only one Muhammad Ali.
Well, thank you for the question. I think this is one of the most urgent issues facing America today, our debt and our deficit. So last fiscal year, the U.S. government brought in about $3.3 trillion. We have about $20 trillion in debt. This is completely unsustainable. We are going broke. The day of reckoning is coming soon. And in my opinion, everything is on the table to solve this problem because it is so urgent and it is so important for our security. You know, when I was, this whole idea of we can grow our way out of it, I really don't like that argument. When I started my business, I didn't go out and rent a 10,000 square foot facility and hire a bunch of people and say, well, I'm going to just grow my way into this business. No, we need to tackle the problem where it sits now. And something else that I find interesting, when I was an accountant, I did estate tax. And people will go to great lengths to leave their children better off than they were. They will go to a tremendous personal sacrifice for that. And yet, collectively, us as a country, we are willing to leave future generations with a broke country. That is unacceptable. We need to solve these problems. It needs to be part of the dialogue in this country today. If we don't solve these problems in the next 5 to 10 years, it'll be worse. And when we have to go through austerity, which is coming, the people that are going to suffer the most are the least advantaged among us. And I do not want that to happen. We need to take action today so that that doesn't happen and so that we can have a better country, we can be more prosperous into the future. Thank you.
Thank you. The deficit is the biggest problem we're facing. When Obama was first elected, it was about $10 trillion. Today, it's almost doubled into $19 trillion. Folks, we've got to do something about that because if not, my grandkids are never going to be able to dig a hole out of that. So how do we do it? It's the same way we did it in Georgia when I was first elected in 2002. We inherited a deficit from the Democrats, $600 million, over $600 million. And in short order, we had turned it into a $500 million surplus and put it into the rainy day fund. Well, how do you do that? You reduce the size of government and you reduce spending. It's not rocket science. Washington's been out of control with the deficit. We've got to do that. We've got to protect our grandchildren. And with the experience that I had in the Georgia State Senate, I can get my sleeves rolled up again and start to do the hard work. Again, Dan Moody, I'd love to earn your vote.
These three things are not mutually exclusive. When I was in the state senate, we lowered taxes. I led the legislation through the state senate that ended up taking the sales tax off of food items. So for 20 years, we've not been paying taxes on food items, and that really helps working families in Georgia. For the deficit, we always have a balanced budget in the state and we're able to accomplish that. But let me talk about transportation because that's a huge need for this area. We're not going to be able to continue to attract companies and bring in jobs if we don't have answers to our transportation problems. The perimeter CID has issues that they need funding. As Congressman, I'm going to work to get federal funding back into the district Primer CID has projects. We have the Peachtree Gateway Partnership that's going to connect Dunwoody to Doraville, Brookhaven, Chamblee with bike trails and walking trails. We need more connectivity in our community. We're redeveloping the GM plant in Doraville. They have needs for additional federal funding for transportation needs for bridges. So as Congressman, know that I will go up there and work to bring transportation back to our community. It's going to help continue to create jobs in the community. Thank you.
We're not going to be able to cut our way out of this. We need to work on parallel tracks, both on the cut the budget side as well as pro-growth policies. I really believe that when it comes to our national security, a $20 trillion debt is perhaps one of the biggest threats to our country and our future that we're facing. And we need to have people who are going to be serious about making the hard decisions that need to be made today. We need a balanced budget amendment so that we can start passing balanced budgets out of Congress to stop the hemorrhaging and then be able to start to tackle that debt. Number two, we do need to have pro-growth policies, tax reforms that lower the rates on individuals and corporations, and especially for small businesses, a permanent repeal of the estate tax so that our Main Street small businesses can thrive for generations to come. When it comes to our infrastructure, that is an investment in our future. It's an investment, and we need to work really hard to partner with our local elected officials. I don't think it's Washington's job to tell your local leaders what to do, but I want to work in partnership with them to figure out how we actually do it. So we have to get serious about this debt, a balanced budget, pro-growth policies and reducing tax rates, taking a look at the owner's regulatory climate so we can get this economy growing at a faster clip than it currently is, and that will lead to more jobs and better paying jobs, and get serious about making the hard decisions in this budget.
We leave a lot of money while we're sitting there in the Georgia 400. We definitely need to get our infrastructure fixed. It's costing us a lot of money. We can use technology to solve a lot of these problems. We can have smarter cities. We can have autonomous driving cars. We can have mobile apps, you know, with ride sharing. And, you know, there's a lot of things that we can do to to save energy and the cost for running cities and different things. We also need, as I mentioned, that we need higher paying jobs, and we do bring in a lot of H-1B visas, especially here in north of, you know, District 6. Those jobs, we definitely need a lot more women in technology. We need inner city youths in technology. We need legacy workforce in technology, and that's what I've been doing for the last 4 years, is teaching, educating, learning bleeding edge technology to make sure that we, District 6, have those jobs of the future. Thank you.
I got a question for the audience. How many small business owners in here? Raise your hand. Everyone look around. Local shop owners, etc. Did you know that we pay 80% of taxes to the nation's war chest or treasury bill, or if you want to call it, or checkbook? Did y'all know that? So imagine the payroll taxes. Imagine the payroll taxes that were so choked and inundated under, where we can't even grow our companies. Imagine it going all the way down to 15%. You gonna tell me you couldn't grow your company or incentivize your employees or offer affordable health care? Think about that. Ladies and gentlemen, the swamp has Democrats and Republicans swimming in it right now in D.C. I'm telling you, it does. This is an aggressive plan. What attracted me the most about getting on board early with President Trump was the $1 trillion infrastructure. We will get that accomplished. And I've always said the biggest fight will not be so much as repealing Obamacare. Watch what happens, ladies and gentlemen, in a few months when we start tug-of-warring on this tax, draining this. Because remember, when you drain something, something's got to give. So as Bruce Lavelle, 25 years of the small business, I understand inventory tax, payroll tax, sales tax, ad valorem tax. My God, alarm fee tax. Are you kidding me? I paid 37% last year. You think I don't know about how that feels? Nobody on this stage, nobody in this district has a relationship with the president and the entire administration that will fight to bring back transportation dollars in the 6th. We have the number one worst traffic corridor, February 25th. Y'all saw that? Think about Bruce Lavelle when you commute downtown tomorrow. Bruce Lavelle, thank you.
I just want to say, Bob, you said something that I agree with this time around, and it's the numbers don't mean anything, and it's the truth, and here's why. Look up the F-35. Just look that up, and you will see that's $1 trillion for nothing. Look up the $6.5 trillion that the Pentagon has lost over the last 10 years, and Congress has not lifted a finger. So you're telling me we could lose this type of money, and we don't have money to invest in poisoned waterway systems that are in the United States of America today? We could fix those today if we had the political will to stand up to the private interest, the special interest, and the moneyed interest who are preventing it from happening. We could do that today because, frankly, $20 trillion, it doesn't mean anything. It's a number that's going to, it'll keep going up, it'll be whatever. It's an arbitrary number because we have the money to do these projects if we had the political will to do it. If we could drop $80 billion on a runway that was used the very next day, don't tell me we don't have money to fix the poison waterway systems. I mean, even here in Atlanta, in Metro Atlanta, they had high levels of lead. So the money's there for these infrastructure projects. We just need to have the political will to do what's right for the country, for the people first, and that's what I intend to do. As being the only truly independent candidate, I've decided that I'm putting the people first before this special money and party interest, and I'm gonna work for the people first, and these are the types of projects that we could do. Investing in infrastructure, jobs today, and growth into the future, and always knowing who we work for. Thank you.
I have to agree with Hernandez, on Alexander Hernandez, on we do have enormous debt, and there's so much waste, fraud, and abuse, not to sound cliche, but and there's a lot of great ideas up here amongst all of us, but the reality is it goes back to what I said at the beginning. Washington's not doing what they should be doing, and as long as they're operating under, every year they increase the federal department spending by 3%, I think it is. We need to go to zero baseline budgeting, number one. Also, this month of April, we're coming up where the budget's ending, the government's not going to have funding, and somebody's going to be screaming, government shutdown, government shutdown. They're not in session even half the month, I don't believe, in April. But they plan it that way. They're in charge of the calendar. The House is in charge of the purse strings and the calendar. And so what do? They run it up against their 3 days in session, and then they're screaming at everybody, you got to vote for this, you got to vote for this, or you're going to shut down the government. That's not the way the government should be operating. And until we fix the way that Washington's operating, all these great ideas up here, none of it's going to matter. We need tax reform. We do, I believe, on individuals and on corporations, but it needs to be partnered with lessening regulations. We need to give businesses, small businesses and corporations, incentive again. You jumpstart the economy by lowering taxes. It puts money back into the pockets of the individuals, and I believe that we can spend our money better than Washington, D.C., and then money will be in there for us to spend on infrastructure and other things.
For me, this is not a hypothetical. This is not just talk. Talk, I believe, is really cheap here. I believe you got to look at who has the resume. My resume didn't stop 5 or 10 years ago. I've been delivering this year for you on this very issue. Georgia has over $2 billion in our rainy day fund, in our savings plan. As your Senate Finance Chairman for the last 4 years, I've been delivering for you for the last 4 years and a lot longer. Because the answer to this question is, I believe, twofold. Yes, you got to cut your taxes. I wrote perhaps the largest single income tax cut in the state's history in 50 plus years. We passed it out of the Senate last year. In fact, we passed two. The House of Representatives took it up. We're still fighting there. I know these issues. I fought for these issues. And yes, I have an economics degree from Emory University, but I fought on these issues. And when I was serving with President Ronald Reagan, he said, the government's, you know, the joke is, I'm with the government, I'm here to help you. That's wrong. We need to cut the size of government. We can walk and chew gum at the same time, guys. We can walk and chew gum at the same time. What I mean by that, we can cut spending. We're spending $3 for every $2 this nation brings in. That's wrong because you and you and you don't have more money to save, invest, and spend, and invest in new businesses and job creation. I've got a proven track record. The stakes are too high to choose somebody who doesn't. The stakes are too high to choose somebody who this is just merely a hypothetical. I'm Judson Hill. Go for the proven conservative who can win. Thank you.
A community, a society, a country says a lot about its values and its priorities by how it seeks to balance the books, what kind of tough decisions it makes. There is plenty of room for belt tightening in Washington, hundreds of billions of dollars every fiscal year that have been identified by Congress, by the Government Accountability Office, by inspectors general in federal agencies as duplicative, wasteful, unnecessary, even fraudulent. We need to attack that wasteful spending so we can bring fiscal responsibility back to Washington. What I think is not consistent with this community's values is to balance the budget on the backs of low-income children, of seniors, of clean air and clean water. We have to make tough choices, and they have to be tough choices that are consistent with our values. By the same token, as we engage in a bipartisan effort to reform the tax code, to improve certainty and competitiveness, we have to make sure that the benefits of that reform effort do not flow only to the largest organizations, but that we level the playing field for small and medium-sized businesses too. And as we, and I hope that there will be an opportunity for Republicans and Democrats in Congress to work together on an infrastructure package that's fiscally responsible, that delivers improvements that this community, we know now more than ever, needs urgently to attract more jobs and investment to our area.
My name is Kurt Wilson, and Dick, John, a lot of that stuff sounds really good. But here's the problem. This is exactly the reason I, as a normal citizen, got into this race. Because the reality is, in the year 2049, 100% of our budget dollars go to four items. Today, 7 out of $10 go to those four items. It's interest on the debt, Medicaid, Medicare, and Social Security. In 12 years, in 2029, Social Security funds run out. So there'll be an automatic decrease of 27% benefits as of 2030. So we have to get real as citizens. And we have to go back to the principles that made us a great country and free people. It was limited government and free markets. And devolve the power of government back to local communities. We are on the wrong sphere. We've been on the wrong sphere for 80 years. And it's breaking the backs of us as American people, and it's ruining the rule of law. And we're forgetting who we are as a people. We became a great people because of our freedom, of our ability to make choices, of suffering the consequences of failure and enjoying the great successes from those decisions. We have to return to what made us a great country. It's free market principles, and it's limited government. Thank you very much. My name is Kurt Wilson.
I think that big corporations need to get rid of their corporate welfare. That's number one. Small and medium-sized businesses employ most of Americans. We need to give them some tax relief, as well as some of their regulations need to be lessened. I work for a company that spends millions of dollars a year just on regulations and doing mundane tasks that really don't help anyone out. And we need to relook at some of the regulations that are put on small and medium-sized businesses that are private and publicly traded. As far as the deficit, what we need to do is we need to invest in our children. We need to make sure that we are allowing them to get affordable education. If we can make sure that we build a strong generation that will be able to be leaders in innovation in technology and in other areas, we will be able to lessen our deficit and make sure that we have a surplus and we continue to have a surplus in the long run. As far as infrastructure, we need to definitely spend on infrastructure. We can't have freeways, you know, falling and caving in on themselves. So we definitely do need to spend in that area, but we have ways that we can definitely help for the future. My name is Reagan Edwards. Vote for me on April 18th.
William Lott, CPA, sounds like a job for an accountant. Anything? Okay. Okay, lower taxes, sure. 35% corporate. The president's recommending 15%. You know, it needs to go to 25%. Let's step softly here, baby steps. Reduce the income tax rate on middle-income Americans. We're the ones paying the most tax. 42% of the population doesn't pay any tax anyway. We need to get special interests out of the tax code. The retirement contributions, 99% of us are paying into a 401k or an IRA, where we're putting away $50,000 a year in contributions on the retirement side. Certain individuals are afforded a luxury of a $200,000, $300,000, $500,000 a year deduction. Let's just get the special interest out of the tax code. Deficit reduction, it's the wage base. Increase the wage base, we have more people paying taxes. They fall off the welfare programs. They don't want to be on the welfare programs. They want self-respect. On the infrastructure, there's a donee and donor state. We are a donor state. We get taxed on our gasoline tax, yet we don't get to spend the money locally. So I will fight for making sure that that's an even deal. Because right now, we're getting beaten up on the gasoline tax. Thank you so much. LLOP.
I'm Dr. Rebecca Quigg, and I think the Congress needs to do the hard work that we all do in our own households and businesses, which is to scrutinize what we're paying for bills, how we're saving for college, how we're paying for our rent or mortgage, and for retirement. They just won't do it. Because there's money in politics. The special interests don't want them to exclude what favors them in the tax situation. You know, Newt Gingrich from this district and Bill Clinton worked in the 90s for a balanced budget bill with the assistance of John Kasich. When John Kasich was running for president, he admitted that the president took us to an unwarranted war based on false information, blew our budget out of the water. This put money in the pockets in the military industrial complex, namely Halliburton, which is virtually owned by Dick Cheney. That's where it all went. We need to undo this, and we can't get into another war with millions of dollars spent on missiles that went to Syria without a clear plan as to what that was all about. Of course, if it's needed, and of course, if our country's threatened. But we need to fix that problem in a diplomatic way, not increase the military budget by $54 billion, which was Trump's presentation. I think that the average income being $57,000 a year with 75% of people living paycheck to paycheck, we need a fair graduated income tax based on income independence and not to benefit those at the higher incomes with corporations paying literally nothing and putting their money overseas. Thank you.
This is going to be the last question. There are a lot of topics we were not able to cover today because it takes a half an hour to ask a question. If you would like to explore other issues with these candidates, we've invited them to stake out a spot in the lobby. We have the building for an additional hour. Don't know how long the candidates will be here, but I suspect if you're here, they'll be here. So feel free to follow up with them after this is over. So for the final question, Dr. Quigg, you get first go at this, and it is a simple question. What role should Congress play in combating climate change?
Thank you. That's a very important question. First of all, we don't put a law before Congress that we're going to dismantle the EPA in 2018. We don't decrease funding by 25%. If anyone's been around it long enough, you know how much our pollution situation has improved in many places, but yet we see the waterways here in Georgia, the Chattahoochee Ridge, are getting dirtier. We cannot go the wrong direction. This affects the economy because we need to have systems in place to keep our country clean, our children healthy, and our lands, and also situations such as the lead in the pipes in Flint, Michigan, and all over this country. We need to have more restrictions, not less. We need to have energy systems that are clean and don't pollute the air. I'm not for fracking oil or gas. I'm not for the Dakota pipeline or the other pipelines that could risk damaging the water and the air in those areas and putting people's health at risk. We need improvements in the EPA, more restrictions. We don't need an EPA director that was put in there to get rid of it because he sued the EPA 14 times when out of the state of Oklahoma because he failed to follow guidelines. We need to fight for this. And there's going to be more protests about this around the state of Georgia and Atlanta. And I welcome you to go out there and fight against this new law that's up in Congress. Thank you.
Yes, LOP, L-L-O-P. Climate change. We just need to be responsible. We know that we're polluting the air. We don't want to turn into a China and wear a gas mask. And to accomplish that, I think we need to keep the EPA moving. Now, we have reached a tipping point over the last 8 years where we were putting too much regulation on people. So let's back off a little bit and let's get that straight. Responsible waste. Responsible waste. Who's really paying for the plastic bottles? Well, we are. You know, so back in my day, you bought a bottle and you paid the nickel and you took the case of bottles back and then you got some money back. Well, we're just throwing this stuff away, and this needs to be in our roads and in our, not in our landfills and certainly not in our oceans. There's an island out in the Pacific right now that is a plastic whirlpool of mess. Who's footing the bill? Our children. Let's fix it. Let's keep it clean and let's move forward. William Lowe for Congress. Thanks.
I definitely feel that we should support the EPA. We've had it since President Nixon was the president that it started under. And we definitely need to keep it. We definitely need to stop coal runoff that's polluting our water systems. Already in Cobb County, if you go to the website, you have to boil the water for 15 minutes before you can ingest it. So we need to make sure that we have clean water. I also believe that pesticides, the executive order that Trump signed that allowed some very harmful pesticides to be used on food products, we have to work to get that change. We have to protect our children, and that those pesticides actually can cause brain damage in children. But he signed an executive order that made it okay. So we have to make sure that we are vigilant on all fronts, whether it be our food, our water, the Flint, Michigan crisis that, you know, there was actually lead found in water at Atlanta schools as well. So I think we all probably need to get a test kit and make sure that our water's fine as well. So, yes. So I definitely believe that we should make sure that the EPA is protected, that they do not dismantle it, and that we protect our environment. It's Mother Earth. We need our mother. So vote for Reagan on April 18th, and you guys have a wonderful evening.
So my name is Kurt Wilson, and I haven't met anybody in 2017 that's against clean air, clean water, polluting children, having unprotected food. I haven't met anybody yet. Maybe I'll meet somebody that's like that, whether they're a Democrat or Republican. So part of this is a progressive debate that's about 100 years old that's no longer relevant in 2017. We created the Federal Register in 1935. It's basically administrative rules, comes from the federal government. It's 2,000 pages long. In 2015, the Federal Register was 80,000 pages. What's killing our freedom, what's killing us as a people, it's not enough regulation, it's too much regulation, it's too much big government, it's breaking the backs of the free people. I can tell you that most of the federal regulations, being in both in the corporate world and a small business person, get in the way of me doing the right thing more often than they even come close to having people try to do the right thing. Big government is not the answer. Surely in 2017, whether you're a liberal or a conservative, we should know that by now. It is the very threatening to our freedom is to continue to grow government out of control. Government is what's out of control, not us as a people. We need to unleash our free principles and our limited government once again and devolve federal power back to the states and to cities and counties. Thank you very much. Kurt Wilson.
Robert, forgive me, the question was on climate change, was it not? Okay. Here's who agrees that climate change is a major threat to our prosperity and our security. Peer-reviewed science, the military, and the intelligence community. Now, the U.S. made historic commitments in Paris last year to lead the way to reducing global carbon emissions. Importantly, so did China and India, for virtually the first time after decades of foot-dragging. If we walk away from our commitments to reduce carbon emissions and help fight climate change, history will condemn us for it. And rather than more partisanship on this issue, where again there's a consensus from the military, the intelligence community, and science, how about some bipartisanship? How about recognizing that this is a tremendous economic opportunity for Georgia's 6th District to lead the way in clean energy technology, as Mr. Abrams said, to help develop the economy of the future to create more jobs in the economy that will see us into an economic future that we can be proud of, that will yield the kinds of high-tech, biotech, medical research, clean energy jobs that young people here need for the next several decades. Thank you.
I've knocked on over 17,000 doors across North Atlanta over the last handful of years. No one has ever asked me about climate change. Maybe they were thinking about other things like job creation and how to educate their kids, traffic congestion, low-cost health care that's affordable and actually works for them. Maybe they want a stronger and safer community and a stronger military. They want those things. They want those things. Yes, I'm a fly fisherman. I believe in the environment. I love the environment, frankly. But I think the regulatory aspects of the environment should be handed off to the states. We have an EPA and an EPD, which is the Environmental Protection Department in Georgia. They should be the ones dictating and determining what's in the best interest of each one of you, in my opinion. Federalism does work and back closest to the people. At the same time, you actually build out your highways and byways and your roads, because the federal government is the problem with building roads through the environmental protection agencies. We need an energy independent America, because we're safer and we're stronger when we do so. The individuals here that are you and the small business owners, we need to stand up and strengthen and protect you and get government out of your way. That's probably why Bernie Marcus, the co-founder of Home Depot, endorsed me, because my fiscal policies, my economic policies, and the policies that stand up best in the best interest of you. And that's what I hear across this district. Thank you.
Wasn't the question not just about climate change, but what role Congress should have in climate change?
That's correct.
Okay. Well, I'm Amy Kramer, and I'm a big gardener. I'd love to be outside, and probably if you could get rid of the snakes and spiders, I'd spend my life outside. I love it outside, so I'm definitely concerned about our climate. But I, too, am a believer in the 10th Amendment, and I think that anything not relegated to the federal government under Article 1, Section 8, it should go back to the states. And I think that this is something that we should be concerned about as concerned citizens and adults living in our communities. It's up to us to take care of our communities, and it should go back to the states. But any role that Congress is going to play or the federal government is going to play in climate change, I think it is incumbent upon Congress, because they have oversight over the federal bureaucracies and the regulatory agencies. So if you don't like what Congress is doing, then change Congress. And I think that that's what's happened recently, and I think people are tired of big government.
So Congress absolutely has a role in climate change, because it's a national security issue. John pointed out that the military and the intelligence community have said we have to take care of this. A lot of folks right now, a big issue you've been hearing at every door, though, is refugees and immigration and things of that nature. If you think it's bad right now, just wait till these effects start really kicking in, and you will see mass displacements all across the world, people trying to flock to where there's water, because that's what we need to live. So this is a national security situation that Congress must definitely be involved in. We need to be take an active role and make sure we do whatever we can to make sure that we prevent it from getting worse. We're already seeing droughts. There was a drought in here for a good year. There was a drought out in this country alone. There's droughts across the world. Things are changing and we're affecting it in a way. We have to do what we can. We have to put all the resources available to make sure that we prevent it and bring us back from the brink, essentially. We don't have the resources to deal with something if we don't act now. And it's our security that really depends on it. And since Congress is supposed to have an active role in national security, we better get on it. Thank you. My name is Alexander Hernandez, yourvotegeorgia.com, and I hope I can count on y'all's support.
You notice who didn't swing this time. That's all right. You know, one thing, you know, that really attracted me about Dunwoody is its camaraderie and its togetherness with their community. And is the reason why I expanded my business out here in the city of Dunwoody. Congress should be backing up folks like Terry Nall here, city council member, Mayor Denny Shortle, Doug Thompson here, wonderful, magnificent city council, magnificent Dunwoody Homeowners Association that has a huge attendance. When if you want to build something in this city, honey, trust me, they will have 1,000 people at your door. And that's where it comes from, it's local control. And that's what Congress should be doing, is supporting these brilliant leaders here in this city to let them make the decisions, not someone in DC trying to look, you know, down in your yard as doesn't know anything what's going on. So I'm a strong advocate of local control and putting it back into the people and what's right, what's wrong. We all know what's right, what's wrong. We know not to dump stuff in streams, et cetera. But I will tell you this, I'm very optimistic about the $1 trillion infrastructure, because what a lot of people don't realize, there's a tremendous amount of money that goes into that question that they ask about, how can we protect our waterways and everything. When you build infrastructure, that big plan is part of that infrastructure plan. Bruce Lavelle can deliver that back to the infrastructure. Bruce Lavelle, thank you.
Andre Pollard, the techparty.us. A couple of years ago, I had the opportunity to visit China. I was in Wuhan, China, which is about 2 hours away from the ocean. And I wore a white shirt starting off early in the morning. And by the end of the day, that white shirt was no longer white. It was like a tannish brown. The rivers and streams that I cross over, you wouldn't want that water to spill on you because you're afraid of what's in it, because it's like a black color water. What I'm saying is that the United States, the leaders of the free world, and again, we assumed responsibility this week, and even though I was against some of the way we did it, but this current administration, at least, for the first time, is looking outward, not just at itself, but trying to let the world know that we are still the leaders in the free world, and we need to lead in the environment also. We need to dictate to other countries like China, the big polluters, that this is one planet, and we all have to share it, our kids have to use it, and we need to enact laws and work and with cooperation with other countries to promote sound environmental policies. Andre Pollard, the techparty.us.
I see Congress' role in this area as one of being limited, so that the state and local governments are really helping to drive the way. Over the past 8 years, we have seen perhaps the biggest step forward in regulatory overreach out of Washington, D.C., certainly in my lifetime. We, every one of us, whether you are a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent, you care about our planet, you care about our communities, you want clean water, you want clean air, all of those things. We all have an obligation and a responsibility to be responsible stewards. I think, though, that what has happened is that this has become a political football. Really, folks, do you really think that that puddle that welled up in your backyard during the big storms the other day should be designated as a navigable waterway? Really? So we need to find the right balance between doing the right thing and having a just a lick of sense around all of this. I'm Karen Handel. I'm going to work hard to earn your vote on April 18th. Thanks for letting us be here.
Climate change is real, and Washington has gone the wrong direction. I got into this race because we've got to move this country forward. We talked about protecting our water. The Republicans passed legislation to allow toxic coal ash to be dumped in our rivers. That's going the wrong way. We talked about, yes, go ahead. Think about how far the Chattahoochee River runs right through the district, how much advancements we've made in 25 years to clean the Chattahoochee River. We have to stand up and protect our water. What about our air? Do you remember how Atlanta metro area was 15 years ago? We were the asthma capital of the nation. But we've worked to close down coal-burning plants. And that's the number one reason our air quality is so much better. But what's the Republican administration doing now? They're trying to stop the clean power plant. We can't stand for that. That's going the wrong way. We've got to go forward. When it comes to what's happening, we see the fossil fuel industry taking over Washington. That's taking us in the wrong direction. We've got to go to a clean energy economy with solar and wind. Georgia's one of the five fastest growing states in the solar development. We've got to continue that way. Listen, thank you. And John, you're right. We've got to support the Paris agreements because we have obligation in this world to lower carbon emissions. We've got to be able to look at our children and say, we did everything in our power to try to make this a more healthy and sustainable planet for you and future generations. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. There's been a common theme so far, and I think you're going to hear it continue. And that is, none of us want to leave a legacy to our children of something that they're going to have to dig out of. And in terms of the climate control and environmental issues, it does get down to the local level. The government that works the best is closest to the people. And you folks in Dunwoody know that better than anybody. Now, I spent 35 years of my business career in the measurement instrumentation business. I'm an electrical engineer. I understand how you measure these things and you can make them better. And by golly, we have made some good improvements, but it's not because of all the bureaucrats that have grown and grown and grown. They don't even know what they're doing anymore. We've got to get that out of Washington. We've got to push it down to the state level and further than that as well, and let the local governments take control of some of these issues. Thank you.
Well, this is an issue I know quite a bit about. As John said, I spent the last 6 years running a business where we converted vehicles to run on a cleaner fuel that reduced carbon emissions, reduced particle pollution by about 90%. And so, as we know, vehicles are the number one causes of carbon emissions out there. But my take is a little bit different. The EPA was the biggest obstacle that I had in business over some really silly regulations. And if I explained them to any reasonable person, they would understand how silly these regulations were. They were working against what we were trying to do to clean the environment. So that's issue number one. Also, we need to understand not all issues have a government solution. So most of my customers, they wanted to convert to a cleaner fuel. Yes, because it saved money, that was important, but also because it was good for them and their image in the community. We need to have some social power and not just say to the state, say to the government, this is your problem. No, we need to take responsibility. This is all of our problems. Let's look at companies that are making the right decisions, that are going towards a cleaner environment, a cleaner technology, and let's encourage that. Let's say, I want to buy from you. I want to encourage you. So this is something we all need to do together. Also, last thing, you know, the stimulus that was passed, a lot of it went into alternative fuels, and I saw vehicles that were converted and then were mothballed 6 months later and were switched to vehicles that were much dirtier, much bigger. Government doesn't always work. It's social power. It's us as citizens that can make a difference, and I spent the last 6 years of my life trying to make a cleaner environment for this country. Thank you.
I'll answer the question and challenge you. Yes, climate change is real. We need to do everything possible to have clean air, clean water, and other, whatever needs to be done. But you are all responsible. I'm responsible because you have been sending people knowing that these people have been sold out to special interest groups with tons of money. You still elect them. So you are responsible. You need to change that. And I want to challenge you. Here's a printed page from Federal Election Commission, FEC.gov. I want you to go there. I'm the only candidate claim that I have rejected all special interest money. And I'm going to just give you one example. $8.3 million for this election, 95% came from outside. And Mr. John Ossoff has been sold out to this interest group. So how on earth he's going to do anything? You need to make up your mind whether you want to send one more already sold out to special interest group or you want to send an independent who can stand up to the system. Thank you.
I'm not an electrical engineer, but I am a physics major. And climate change is real. Local control to control climate change, I don't understand how that works. We need, this is, constitutional scholars should read the first words of the Constitution. Provide for the common defense. Promote the general welfare. If this existential, economic, and military problem, recognized, as John said, by the intelligence community, by military experts, by sociologists, by scientists everywhere. If this does not go to what Congress has been delegated to do as a major problem, this is not your garden. This is not organic, I'm gonna stop, I'm not gonna throw the bottle out in the backyard and then climate change is gonna go away. It's a scientific existential crisis for us.
Getting a little heated in here. So I'll give the other argument. One. It's all right, the master's is on. Here's the thing. Number one, I believe in climate change. Number two, this is what people who believe in big government do. They make you afraid, they give you a fear, and then they conduct a power grab. That is what this is. This is absolutely a power grab. Now, you know, we all want a clean environment. I believe in common sense solutions to that. But what role should Congress have? Maybe by creating the business environment where people like David's company can excel and we can work on this as a global power. Congress's approval rating hovers between 12 and 19%. If I just told you that we have the greatest threat to humanity, why would you trust those people to solve it? And that's what this is all about. So I think this is a power grab. It is an issue, but Congress and the people in those halls are not the people that are going to solve it for you. People like David are.
I grew up in Buffalo, New York, and when I was a boy, I can remember looking at a park down in the city of Buffalo, and you couldn't see it. The smoke was so thick, the pollution was so great, you just couldn't see it. I've spent time in China, India, Brazil, I've seen what pollution looks like. There's nothing inconsistent, I think, with being a Republican and an environmentalist. I'm an outdoorsman. I want to ensure that we have clean water, clean air. I enjoy hunting, I enjoy fishing, I enjoy doing that with my children. I spend a lot of time out west. We absolutely need to have clean water, clean air. This is a national issue. I can tell you from having spent time as a boy growing up and seeing all the pollution that occurs in these other countries, to think we can solve this problem on a local level, I just don't think is realistic. It is a national issue, but we have to have a common sense approach. We've got to have a common sense approach to it, and we do not have that today. The EPA is just on overreach, on overdrive. We've got to have a simplistic approach to how we manage the environment in a clean way. And we've got to balance that with economic growth, however. And we can do that with the advancing technologies that will allow us to do so. So we need to apply a common sense approach to this. There's nothing inconsistent with being a Republican and an environmentalist, and I just ask you to support a more thoughtful and common sense approach to it. Now, as it relates to global warming, because I do want to answer that question, I don't know. Have any of you looked at the science? I mean, all you hear is the debate between one political side and another.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like a tremendous round of applause for the entire team of panelists. This is an impressive and very diverse group, and we are very appreciative both of their coming today and of their willingness to try to serve us, and we thank you all for your participation today.